Hello, is it Shubhprasad Koirala? Yeah, speaking. Today we had an interview call. Is it the right time we can speak? Yeah, please go ahead. Okay, I'm going through your resume and the current project what you're working with, is it invoicing and accounting? Yeah, it's invoicing and accounting. Okay. So can you explain me what role you're playing in this project? In this project, it is more end-to-end role. So, right from the requirement phase to design to development, I am a part of all the phases almost. So, in the requirement document, I was helping out my project manager to fill in the requirement documentation. So, over there, I was there coordinating with the on-site customer and putting down use cases, putting down whatever notes needed in the requirement documentation to make it complete. After the requirement document was done, I was a part of also of the technical phase to convert the requirement to technical to design. So basically, I was a part of the lower level design as well as the higher level design of the technical documentation. And during the execution phase, I was responsible to help out the developers in case they have difficulties and also to do code reviews to ensure that we follow the proper coding standards, naming guidelines, etc. And then, as a part of support, I was helping out the developers to ensure that the defects are closed and the UAT is signed off properly. So that looks a big role you're playing this project. Oh yeah. Okay. So can you explain me what kind of architecture this project has basically? It's a normal three-tier architecture with like the UI, the BO, and the DAL. For the DAL component, what did you use? The DAL component was a data application block from the enterprise application block library of Microsoft. Okay, so basically it was just a simple three-tier architecture, or was it something more than that? The three-tier architecture was the base of the project. Okay, so basically we had three tiers: the UI, the BO, and the DAL. And the overall architecture we had used is the model view controller. So we basically had the model, the view, and the controller separating each other. In various pockets of the project, we have used different patterns like factory pattern, template pattern, etc. So can you explain me what exactly is factory patterns? Factory pattern is a type of a creational pattern. So it helps you to basically eliminate the new keyword from your UI or from the entities. So in factory pattern, you basically have a class who helps you to create the objects and from the client end or from the client end, you need to use interfaces to reference the concrete objects. So basically, you have a factory class who punches out the objects, and the objects are basically nothing but their references to your concrete classes. Okay. So this was basically Windows or a web form, or it was a web form. Okay, and it was in ASP.NET and C Sharp. I'm seeing over here that it's both the languages C Sharp and BB.NET. So can you explain me why? I mean, there was some part of the coding which was done in BB.NET by third parties. So it was more of a more 98% of C Sharp application, but some part of BB.NET was from the third party. Okay. So can you explain me basically what are sessions and what you call what are session variables exactly? Session variables are they help you to store user specific data. So basically, if you look at the way the HTTP protocol, it's more of a stateless protocol. So you send a request, you get a response, and the server forgets who you are. So basically, session variables help you to make it helps you to retain the states between the request and store the user information. So what are the various ways by which you can store session variables or maintain session variables? There are basically two ways. One is an in proc and one is an out proc. So in proc, the session variables are stored inside the IIS memory itself. While in out proc, you can either use SQL Server or you can either use a state server. Okay. You have also used WCF in your project. You are also well versed with WCF. Yeah, I have a knowledge of WCF. Okay, so what is basically WCF for? I'm going to say, what's the use of WCF as such? Okay, WCF is a part of .NET 3. It actually initiated from .NET 3.0. You can think about WCF is is a way to implement SOA. So it's a technology by which you can implement SOA, or I'll rather say that it's the answer given by Microsoft to implement SOA. It's basically a communication. It's basically a communication foundation. Which integrates different protocols like HTTP, different protocols, different technologies. I'm sorry, not protocols. Different technologies like MSMQ, web services, remoting, all the different communication technologies into one umbrella. With WCF, you can create services and you can expose those services by using XML. But isn't that also done by web services? I mean, to web services also, you can expose your service as XML, and is it same or how it is? Well, as I said, WCF services, WCF is mainly meant to, to implement SOA. So for SOA, one of the important things is to implement the WS-star specifications. If you look at web services, right, they do not implement the complete full-fledged WS-star specification. So because of that, you cannot really build a complete SOA architecture using web services. So that's the first big difference. Second, by WCF, you can host multiple protocols like HTTP, TCP, in other words, you can host your service on multiple protocols like TCP or HTTP. While in WCF services, in web services, you need to only use the IIS and the HTTP protocol. Okay. What are address bindings and contracts in WCF services? Address defines where the service is hosted. So it defines a URL or the URI where we can locate the service. The binding defines what kind of protocol it is. Is it HTTP? WS-HTTP, basic HTTP? What kind of protocols on which the service will host? And the contract basically defines the necessary data types, the necessary functions which are going to be exposed to the world. So it's more of like a what interfaces are going to be used. So A, B, C are nothing but where, how, and what. Okay. You have also used reporting services in your tools. I can see reporting services. So what are the various ways by which you can consume reporting services, reports in .NET or in ASP.NET? But there are two ways by which you can consume reporting services in your ASP.NET project. The first one is by using the URL technology. So when we actually publish a report in reporting services, it's been hosted on IIS. So that is a it has basically a RDL file, the report definition language file. So it hosts on the report server IIS, and that IIS, the URL you can directly invoke and get the report. So one is the URL technology you can use, and the other one is we have a reporting control, a report viewer which is given. You can use the report viewer to basically get the reports. So internally it actually makes a call to a web service. So so basically you can summarizing, there are two ways. One is a URL way, and another one is a web service way. So to implement the web service way, you need to use the report viewer. While the URL way, you can just give the URL from your application and the report runs.